IVM.
Hello and welcome to the Habit Coach Podcast. I am Ashton Doctor, your habit coach, and today we have a special episode. We have a guest who is the founder of And Nothing Else. He's a food blogger and he's going to share with us his amazing fitness journey from being extremely overweight to losing all of it to putting it back on and yo-yoing in between multiple times. He finally found his own set point, his own equilibrium, and has now realized what it takes to be fit. So this is going to be the first part of this podcast with him, where we talk about his journey. In the second episode, we're going to be talking about how he started as an entrepreneur in this whole food space. What is it like? Is it worth it? And how does he feel that this passion project of his is going to grow? So join me in welcoming Shashank Mehta to the Habit Coach Podcast.
Hey, Ashton. Thank you so much for having me here. I'm so excited about this.
We met actually working out in a gym in Bandra. And our passion for fitness got us together talking. And I think it's a fantastic opportunity, especially in this time, to be an entrepreneur in the health space, on the fitness space. And, you know, I love the way that he went about approaching it and the way that his brand has grown throughout. So I wanted to do this podcast for multiple reasons, because I wanted to show people what life is like, A, as an entrepreneur. Also, Shashank's story on how he got into health and fitness is very interesting. And, you know, how he thinks about moving ahead and where this fitness industry probably will be going towards, and why And Nothing Else is actually leading a path in this direction. I'm super excited because, you know, we've been planning this podcast for a while before this whole lockdown started. And we're actually recording from our own home, so I know the audio quality is going to be not as expected as from a studio. Maybe we might have a pressure cooker blasting off in the background or something.
No worries. We'll try and make up for bad audio quality with great content.
Perfect. Love it. So Shashank, you know, let's dive straight into it. I heard your story on how you got into fitness. Can you share that with the listeners? Like, what was your journey like?
Sure. So it's a bit of a long, almost a lifelong journey across a winding road, as I might say. It's a sinusoidal curve. So around when I was 19 years of age, I was 105 kgs. And at 5 wow. feet, 9 inches, that's quite a lot. And then I was also, and maybe this part of the story I've not even told you, Ashton, I was also at that time diagnosed with a very, very rare back disease called Shurman's disease. Happens to a 1 in a million people for no reason of DNA or hereditary anything, which basically means that your spinal cord gets bent. It's actually a hunchback, which is not due to posture. It is your spinal cord getting bent. So I was that fat, and this happened to me. And the doctor told me that your old age is going to be really, really tough because of this, unless you do something about your fitness. He also told me that no matter what you do, you'll never be able to, you know, run more than 3 or 4 kilometers, given how badly your back is shaped. I guess the competitive middle class topper in me got challenged, and that's how the first weight loss started off. And the first weight loss journey, I lost some 35 kgs in 9 months. I just went batshit crazy.
35 kilos in 9 months. Okay, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I just went batshit crazy. I stopped eating. I started running. I had this random theory at that time that the more I sweat, the more I lose weight. So I used to go out running in June and July in Delhi summer at 12 p.m. because that was the hottest. At noontime because that was the hottest.
In Delhi,
time.
They have this thing called the Loo Chalti Hai, right? And that's when you're normally not supposed to go out. Huh.
So I went so mad. I was like, this is the right time because I will sweat the most. And it'll be most efficient use of my exercising time. So that was the first weight loss. And I had absolutely no education about the body and nutrition, etc. at that time. So I lost weight. I thought that I've become a thin guy now. And hence I'm a fit guy now. And hence I can eat like all my thin friends around me who could eat anything and stay the way they are. I started doing that. In another 3 years, all the weight came back. Then I lost it again. Yeah, it did, like about 25 kgs came back by the time I realized, oh shit, this is happening again. By that time, I was doing my MBA at IIM Lucknow, and life was crazy hectic in an IIM MBA. So I couldn't do much about it. But the minute I joined a job, I got back to my running, etc., lost all that weight again. This time also, while I was a little better educated this time, I still didn't understand that my metabolism and my body will never be like someone, you know, the composition is entirely different. In the job, once stress started piling up and I joined a startup at that time also, again, work became a lot. And I again put on 25 kgs before I knew it. This time, the third time over, I was like, this is getting a bit much. That's when I started educating myself about my food and nutrition. And I thought I'll do it right this time. And that third journey, once it ended and I lost all that weight and started putting on some muscle to increase my BMR, etc., is when I started writing the blog, which is FitShit. Which eventually turned into the startup that's and nothing else. But that's the that's the long and short of it.
Shashank, you must make a post on your total weight loss, like 35 kilos, 25 kilos, 35 kilos. That's like almost 100 kilos plus whatever you did right now.
Yeah. Like,
can you imagine the amount of food that's gone in and out of you?
In and out, yeah.
Crazy. I want to take out two, three important things from what you said. The first one is obviously, you know, what the doctor did to you. He pushed you into a challenge, you know, almost giving you that burning incentive of making sure that I will show him kind of mindset. I had a similar thing happen with me when one of our close family friends said, Ashton, you're going to, you know, be good for nothing. Nothing ever going to happen with you. You're just going to waste your life. And that was like my kick up my ass to start doing something. Work-wise, this was something health-wise that was a kick up your ass. And I think it's a fantastic opportunity. You know, many people have people saying this to them all the time and they don't take it as an opportunity to, I will show them. They take it as an, you know, a beat down. And changing that mindset is so important for us. The second thing I wanted to highlight was losing weight is easy if you basically understand and have knowledge. Losing weight and keeping it off is easy if you know the knowledge behind it. But most of us are just not aware of the knowledge. So we get into, like you said, these waves and these patterns of putting on weight, losing weight, putting on weight, losing weight. And has your mindset changed with regards to weight? Do you still think about weight? Do you think about inches? Do you think about muscles? Do you think about progress pictures? How do you track that now?
So I think logically, my brain now understands that fitness is not equal to weight. So I track, I used to track body fat, but then I realized that the electrical impedance machines that we use are themselves fairly flawed. Then I moved on to just looking at the mirror and, you know, figuring out from the look of the body, how I'm doing, etc. But have I completely been able to overcome this obsession with not getting physically fat? I would say, I don't know. It's such a deep-rooted thing because my entire teenage life, I was an obese kid. I lived with that. Yeah, so I don't think I've fully overcome it, but my definition of fitness has obviously become a lot more nuanced now. To put it in a nutshell, I used to think that fitness is equal to weight. Now, I think fitness is equal to endurance, strength, and flexibility. And hence, okay. I judge myself on progress on each of these three fronts to say that as a composite, is my fitness moving forward or not? So, for example, about 3 years back, I did the entire, I will put on muscle, I will eat 150 grams of protein a day, do the entire American marketing thing and you know, become bulked up. I did become bulked up, but I stopped running. I used to be a marathoner. I stopped running because I was spending all my time on building muscle and I'd never done yoga by that time. So I was very, very stiff. So at that time, I used to think because I was looking so good, I thought I'm the fittest. Today, I don't look as good as I used to look at the 3 years ago. But as a composite of these three, I think I'm fitter today than at that time.
Lovely. And I think a large part of all of this knowledge also came from you working on your blog. And when you started doing FitShit, I'm sure, you know, I think it was a success primarily because it was so exciting for you to also learn these things and then share it. That's why, for example, I think the Habit Coach podcast is a success for me, because I find it so exciting getting this information and then sharing. What was your journey like blogging? Because so many people want to become health bloggers, but they don't necessarily get off the ground.
Oh, absolutely. I think I was definitely one of those people who kept, you know, who's always thought that there's a novel inside me and I need to write. And I think every other person thinks that. Actually, the one habit which got me to write the blog is getting into the habit of just getting up every weekend. I was in a corporate job. Saturday, Sundays were off. Getting up every weekend, hauling my ass to that Starbucks where we also met near...
That place.
Yeah. There's a corner there, which is my fixed spot. And for 3.5 years at a stretch, every weekend, if I've been in town, I've gone and sat there for 4 hours each weekend.
Wow.
Yeah. Irrespective of whether words came to me or not, it was actually the physical act of going and sitting there that started bringing the words. So I think, you know, I don't know when it happened, but that dreadful feeling of going and sitting without having anything to type, when it turned into the excitement of, oh, we'll write a new article today. I don't know when it happened, but I'm fairly certain that it happened because the physical act came before the mental act.
Nice. The physical act prompted the mental act to say that, look, I don't want to be in this difficult position of sitting down and then figuring out what to write. Let's now start actually mentally priming ourselves before we actually get into doing it.
Yeah, maybe. And
when you started writing, how long did it take you to write an article? And now how long does it take you to write an article?
Oh, big difference. When I started writing, it would take me at least 2 weekends to finish off one article. One weekend would go and research. Because I'd made a pledge to myself that I won't do... there'll always be two facets to a featured article. One is that it'll be thoroughly researched. So every statement I make, it either needs to come from personal experience or it needs to be backed by research. In most cases, I'll try and do both. Only if those two things intersect will I propagate that school of thought. Otherwise, I won't. So it required a lot of research. So and in the beginning, you don't even know where to look. What are the resources? What are the credible resources? You do a Google search and the first thing that comes up is WebMD, which is like Wikipedia of medical news. So,
and everything leads to cancer.
Yeah, exactly. So it used to take me 2 weekends in the beginning. And about a year and a half into it, I could finish off an article in a day and a half. So less than half a week. Yeah.
How many words typically?
1500 to 1800 words.
Okay. And you know, the interesting thing is I keep telling people that this is the right time to start sharing knowledge and information and starting your blog. Right? Because, you know, blogs are the easiest way of at least getting some form of information moving and credibility moving. Lots of people write and saying, I want to start my own podcast. I want to start my own video thing. What do you suggest? And I think blogs are the best way of at least learning to pen down your ideas. Do you have 2 tips for people for starting their own blog?
I think the first one is again a mental shift. We all keep hiding behind the excuse of the perfect start. And whoever has ever started would tell you that there's nothing called a perfect start. So there's this saying that waiting for the perfect start is the perfect way to never start. So I think that was a big one. As I said, I finally had to swallow my ego, and eventually it comes down to ego that you don't, we are not up to seeing the shit that we'll put out on paper, basically, because it will break the image of how awesome we are in our heads.
Correct.
So I had to overcome that and say that doesn't matter, whatever shit I have inside of me, I need to spew it out so that the good stuff which is lying underneath it can come out after that.
Yeah. Because, so, you know, like you will never love your first podcast. You will never love your first video. You will never love any of the first things that you've done, but you have to just vomit them out, get them out of your system, and put in the practice so that the better stuff starts coming out soon. When people started, you know, even now when people say, I'm listening to your episode 0, episode 1, I was like, Baba, please just start from 20 or something.
No?
Miss all the earlier stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, absolutely. So one is just start.
Yeah. And I would say the second one is, I don't know if it's a writing style that's particular to me, but one thing that really helped me was on day one, when I sit down to write, I write free flowing. I don't care about how it looks, etc. And then the next day when I come back, so I do two things. One, I stop at a time where I feel that I can still go on. I feel that it's very, very important to have something left in the tank to excite you to come back to it tomorrow. If you exhaust the tank today, then the next day you're not excited to, you know, get up and get back at it. And when I come back, I spend a lot of time revising yesterday's draft first. Even if I'd left it at 70% and the article wasn't complete, I go through the draft again. This time I start correcting the grammar. I start correcting the pauses. I start correcting, the highlights, etc. And that, again, gets me into the act of doing something with my fingers, getting operational again, etc. And then thoughts start flowing themselves again. So it again comes back to, you know, without thinking the next day when you get back to the draft, start doing something. Start fidgeting around with yesterday's draft. And dheere dheere, it'll start, you know, putting the mental energy into flow also.
Correct. Absolutely. You know, the big learning from this is that you have to start slowly getting a system in place for anything that you want to start doing or creating, right?
Yes.
So even for you, your system is do a lot of research, sit in one particular position, do the free flow writing, then do the draft one, maybe a draft two, till you're completely satisfied. So I'm sure that there is a system that you put in place. And for everything, there has to be a system, because very often we come in saying that, you know, dekha jayega, let's see what my brain comes up with. And I don't think that's the right way of doing this, because if you want consistency, you have to work in your systems. And after all, your systems are nothing but habits. So you have to get your habits in place to get your systems in place.
You know, if there is actually one biggest thing that I would add as a tip is, you have to commit to a frequency of putting things out.
Correct.
There is just no way around it. No matter how shitty you feel it is, if you've committed that every weekend one thing is going out, it has to go out. That deadline, that habit of putting something out is the biggest motivation to write and to write well. Because if you're going to keep it to yourself, you won't hold yourself to the highest standard. It has to go out. So, absolutely.
Beautiful. So, you know, I can see so many parallels from this to the business that you started and nothing else, right? You were working a corporate job, you wanted to do something. And what was the transition like? First, start off by telling us what and nothing else is a little bit, so that the people who are listening to us know. And then let's talk about how the transition took place.
Sure. So, a large part of doing the Fitchit research and my own personal journey led me to the understanding that, you know, a big reason why I was falling into the obesity trap again and again was because I assumed that I was eating healthy, given what the marketing guys would have me believe, that I was eating high protein and low carb and high in good fat stuff. Because and a large part of our diets today are packaged food. So when I went to the supermarket, I thought that I am replacing my Coke with this fruit juice, which is such a great replacement. I thought that I am replacing I'm a North Indian guy, I'm replacing my morning paranthas with cornflakes, which is such a great thing. Yeah. And it was only when I did the research that I realized that they are just like Coke and fruit juice, especially the kinds that we get in our markets, are exactly the same amount of added sugar. Forget about the natural sugar. And cornflakes are just a way of delivering sugar into your body in the morning. I realized that a big problem with food is, with packaged food, is claims. What in marketing language we call, you know, I used to work with Unilever, I used to work in the personal care department. So for us, claims used to be, fairer skin in 4 weeks and pimples will go away in 2 weeks and stuff like that. And I've seen the marketing jugglery that goes on behind coming up with and supporting such claims. When I realized that the same thing is happening to my food, is when I had the moment of saying, this needs to be corrected, because with personal care, it's one thing, but with food, we can't be doing this, right? So that's where the idea of And Nothing Else came in, that what if there was a brand that just said food should not be about claims and thinner in 4 weeks and keto and low protein, high protein, low carb. Food should be about ingredients. So what if there was a brand that just said that, hey, the food you're about to eat is made of A, B, C, D, E and nothing else. Yeah. That's where the idea of And Nothing Else came about, that can we make food which is so clean that we can declare each and every ingredient on the front of pack. You don't have to turn around the pack. You don't have to look at microscopic font ingredient lists to figure out what you're putting inside your body. And I thought that that idea was really powerful, because it would literally bring the back of pack to the front of pack, which is the habit which everyone who sustainably lost weight would have gotten into the habit of turning the pack around and checking what's gone into the food. You can either fight the battle of making everyone get into this habit, or you can be a leader of change and say that, hey, I'll just bring the back to the front. Right? So that was the thought behind And Nothing Else.
Absolutely. You know, it's so powerful, because like you said, the jugglery that goes around in trying to deceive is so much, especially in the food industry. The number of names that are there for sugar, the number of ways that we will try and make something look fancier than it is so prominent. And I remember about 4 years ago when I think I'd done a post saying that, guys, look what I found on the ingredient list. And I had so many people writing and saying, you actually read that? Like, what's wrong with you? Correct?
Yeah.
You know, you're just supposed to read the label of the product and then you're supposed to understand what's in it. But unfortunately, that's not true. And I went through the same trap as you, by the way. My mornings were breakfast, cornflakes, milk, lots of sugar, and a big glass of juice along with it. And I think that's what put on my 17, 18 kilos at that point of time. So
yeah,
it's quite mad.
Thank you, Shashank, for taking us through that journey. You know, thank you for being so honest and explaining to all of us how this process takes place. Don't forget to join us next time for part 2, where he tells us about his journey into starting And Nothing Else and into entrepreneurship. You don't want to miss that one. If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. If you want to reach out to me, I am Ashtin Doc on Twitter and Instagram. You can find lots more information on my website, awesome180.com, or check out different content on my YouTube channel called AWESOME180. That's Awesome180.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and Intel. It's been a really, really cool week on the network. We've had Ashwin Sanghi on Cyrus Says. We had Masaba Gupta on Advertising is Dead. You should definitely check out Vivek Lath, who showed up on Storytellers and Story Sellers. Close friend and partner of ours, Karthik Padicha, was on the Pragati podcast talking about the future of podcasting, which I think is always really interesting. And I would like to ask people to check out All Things Policy and what they've been doing. They've been having some really interesting discussions about India's challenging relationship with China as we go forward, and I think that would be a great thing for you guys to check out. So with that, we hope to see you again next week.
Advertising is dead. Yep, you heard me right. Advertising is dead. We're all in the content business now. Let's not call it news, TV, radio, etc., etc. It's all content, and we're in the middle of this weirdly exciting phase where all the borders and lines that have been drawn over decades has been swept away by this lovely thing called the internet. We're a show where we don't dwell on just the stuff that is now, but rather the wider stuff about advertising, media, content, and the whole goddamn circus surrounding it. Tune in every Tuesday for our weekly unboxing of the mystery box we used to call advertising. I'm Varun Dugirala, co-founder and content chief at The Glitch, and this is my new podcast, Advertising is Dead.